using quantum annealers for brief periods of time inside some QAOM.
Thanks for your answer for inviting me to this conference, my first quantum annealing conference. In the past, people from my group have been presenting results. I will be talking mainly about this work, if you're here in the archive, I'll be published soon. It's a long discussion, and it's really, in any case, very much work in progress. So this work is developed in the context of this Abacus project. I believe Paul is going to talk about that project tomorrow. So it's the only European effort to build quantum annealers funded by the European Commission. Of course, we work with fast qubits, and we want to implement hard mathematical processes in these qubits. Within this project, one of our tasks is to design the hardware. We have been working on ideas, ideas from our host, Paul Warburton, on how to couple series of junction fast qubits inductively and capacitively, and also to couple qubits to zero semantics. And the goal is to see whether we can understand the coupling limits, understand them from the qubit design, what are the physical limits of these couplings, and whether they can be different from the usual EC models to go towards the non-stochastic world. And then we already have results of the, if you are interested, we can discuss them in this conference. So we have seen already that we can engineer not only the usual magnetic interaction, but also interaction in all three directions by the capacitive couplings. And we also have a very good understanding of how these interactions appear by mediated by the excited state of the plus qubit. But within this research, one thing that I'm very excited about is the possibility of not just looking at qubit-qubit coupling, but really coupling the qubits to other objects, and use those non-perturbative couplings to implement interesting computational models. So what I show here on the left is our whole numerical simulations we did with Alejandro Bermudez and Andreas Kurz, where we studied qubits coupled to resonators from the lattices, and we show that those systems already exhibit the quantum phase transition of the Leeson type, and they can be understood themselves as prototypes of quantum annealers with a different paradigm. Working with these simulators is very nice because it also allows us to better isolate the couplings that we can engineer, as opposed to the qubit-qubit coupling where we have really all kinds of interaction popping up. This allows for very nice designs. And with Manuel Pino, a postdoc that was in my group and now is independent research in Salamanca, we've ensured that you can use the oscillators to steal entropy from the annealer and make it colder through their periodic passage. But that's one line of research, is hardware. I'm going to talk about the different motivation. One of the ideas of the project is that we are going to have coherent quantum annealers, and we want them to be useful for different tasks in quantum simulation. So this is more like a theory algorithmic point of view. I'm going to spend a lot of time in motivation, and also it's very much a work in progress, so really I welcome your feedback and interactions on this line. So what's the idea? What's the main motivation? The main one is that we are going to have, hopefully, one very good quantum simulator with long coherence times, with high flexibility on the couplings that we can achieve. And the question is what we can do with this simulator beyond just preparing ground states, whether we can use this dynamical control of the simulator to target different problems that are both physically interesting or that they have a computational motivation. And ground states is one possible computational motivation, but I'm going to argue that it's probably not the only one. No? So we're going to discuss what we can find here of use in these simulators beyond just preparing ground states. The second motivation is something you know very well, is that quantum annealing is very hard. So the interesting problems, they experience interesting phase transitions, which very rich physics. And we have seen already in the previous talk that if you want to implement the computationally interesting models, you may even have to enforce some multi-qubit coupling, so many qubits simulating one physical qubit, and that even shrinks further the phase transition. So the scalings due to the need of many qubits tunneling at the same time can be problematic. So what can we do in this scenario that is still useful and that really doesn't take us as close to the phase transition as we would like in other consequences, in other scenarios? Or what happens if we don't do this transition adiabatically but diabatically? So the same protocols can be engineered in different applications. And what we may be interested in this is that imperfection is okay in different applications. So usually, well, this is a quantum state, created by a diabatic process. You see that you have many eigenstates with different probabilities. I will explain later how these states are created. And the ground state is here, up on the left, upper left corner, and it has some distant possibility. Typically, it's one reflecting zone, but I want to argue that we have other possibilities. So we could try to lower the probability of all the other states and make a quantum, the ground state the dominant contribution. We know that it's going to require longer adiabatic passages, or we could, if you have a decent probability of success, repeat the experiment more than. So we have this balance, either we make experiments longer, or we use them more often. And this was shown in the previous talk in the initial time to solution metric, which is simply how long we need to use your experiments, either with repetitions or with just longer adiabatic passages. And small increases in the probability of the state we're looking at can lead to very different behaviors algorithmically, asymptotically with respect to the sample. So we can get maybe not exponential improvements, but algebraic improvements that are of practical use. So imperfection is okay, and this idea that you don't need to prepare exact ground states has been used a lot in a different context, which is quantum computing. And in quantum computing, there is this mixed idea that we have noisy devices, and people have been looking at how to use those devices for different computational tasks. And they have arrived at this black box picture where you have your quantum computer and a classical device controlling it, and the classical device simply optimizes its controls, training the computer to do something. It can be to solve an optimization problem, it can be to create or classify quantum or classical data, different class computational tasks. This essentially, if you look at this, it will be like having a quantum simulator. You have a black box there and you're going to operate with some classical parameters that you're going to tune. And well, they are looking at how to create interesting states that are not necessarily perfect solutions, but have a good success probability, and understanding how reaching those states is computationally useful and can provide an advantage over other classical approaches. And two approaches that are very popular within this picture, these quantum variational strategies, are what is called the base variational quantum Engel solver and the QA algorithm. And the first one is simply you have sets of qubits with some entangling interactions. It can be CNOT gates or CSIC gates or other gates that really create entangling between the qubits. And if you change sufficient numbers of those interactions with local controls, you get basically a unitary operation that is parameterized, and it approximates a unitary design. So basically, this unitary explores the Hilbert space in a chaotic way and can reach any quantum state as close as you want. That is not, is potentially very powerful, but the more chaotic your unitary is, the more difficult it is to train it. So there are other approaches that are a little bit more informal the problem, and this one was developed by Fari some time ago. It's called QA, where you use, instead of an arbitrary entangling operation, you use the problem you want to solve. You interleave evolution with your problem, with evolution with local gates, and the whole unitary approximates or is inspired by an adiabatic passage. The difference is that it's digitized. So within these strategies, there are already results that show that already very brief evolutions are computationally hard, and you can have an advantage. These are not very new results, they are from the beginning of the century. So there were some very nice results in the study of ISIM models, on how evolving with an ISIM model for a brief period of time produces a probability distribution that is very hard to sample. These are called with different names. One of them is IQP, instantaneous quantum polynomial algorithms that they are mapped to computationally hard problems, which are computational partition functions. So essentially, if you have a good quantum simulator that simulates an ISIM model, and you just create a non-equilibrium state by evolving it with a brief period of time, what you have is you can sample states from a probability distribution of that quantum state, and imitating that classically requires a lot of resources. If you come up with an algorithm that does that, you don't only break this PNP conjecture, you break the whole polynomial hierarchy, and that's very powerful. Similarly, if you don't have stochastic models, you have XY models, the same thing applies. We showed some time ago that if you have an XY spin model, and you evolve it for a very brief period of time, where you can establish an analogy between that and Boson sampling, and again, you have some probability distributions in your experiment that should be very hard to recreate classically. So we know that it's very hard. So and essentially what I'm trying to argue is that, of course, finding the ground thing is hard, but really reproducing a four-way function is way harder than that. And there may be a computational interest in looking for these other paths. It is be both physically interesting and computationally interesting. The mapping between the physical problem and the computational classes is more difficult. It's more difficult to find problems that are useful, but it's maybe an interesting approach. So in our group, we are interested in a long-term question, two long-term questions, which would be that, what can we do with imperfect and complete adiabatic passages in creating this kind of quantum states or sampling interesting ground states or excited states. So in general, we want to understand the evolution of the simulator, but not necessarily really crossing the phase transition, which is a problem that has been studied a lot, and Adolfo could probably talk about this on Friday, with these cumulative mechanisms and mechanisms for understanding the excitations, but really understanding what kind of states we can create by adiabatic evolution and adiabatic evolutions. In this talk, I'm not going to be so ambitious. We are starting simple. We are starting simply with a brief evolution time. So I'm going to discuss what happens if you have your quantum simulator and evolve with the IC model with the transverse field with a very, for a very brief period of time. I'm going to discuss what kind of probability distributions we create, how we can understand them as intrinsic properties of the models we are simulating. And there's very nice, interesting physics behind it. So what are the rules of the game that I'm going to play? So I'm going to start with a state, uniform superposition is simply the ground state of the transverse field. I'm going to use the language of quantum computing with gates, but the same thing could be translated to a quantum simulator because essentially I have an initial state that is easy to prepare. And then I'm going to evolve with a unitary that is a totalized version of a problem Hamiltonian with a transverse field. And I'm going to do it just once and for a very brief period of time. You see here in the language of gates, gamma and theta are two parameters that essentially tell you both the weights of the Hamiltonian, but also the time we are evolving with these terms. And what I want to understand, essentially, is what happens. So understand what happens for small parameters, theta and gamma. Understand what happens when I train these parameters to really look for the lowest energy states. What states we create and sample at the end of the experiment when we do so. So this seems like a very stupid question. It's one that has been addressed a lot in the literature of quantum optimization because QA is a very well-known algorithm. But we're going to look at it with more care. Okay? So the first experiment I'm going to show is a numerical experiment, of course. I'm a theoretician. I don't have access to a lab. So we're going to prepare a superposition state. We're going to apply unitary evolution to that very simple state for a brief period of time and understand what is the distribution of probabilities in energy space.
May I go to the previous slide?
Yes.
Why are you using RY instead of RX?
This is a technicality. My student wanted to sample both low temperature and infinite temperatures, and negative temperature states. If you put a phase in front of RY, you can basically fit the sign of dynamics. You're going to see it in a minute. If you fix lambda, you can replace it with Rx,
okay,
which will be the usual theory. I'm going to, this is what we have in the paper, but it works the same with ordinary quantum gates, discussing the literature. So what's the initial state?
Sorry, just to make sure I've understood. So the only difference between this and P equals 1 QAOA applying a transverse and
a
longitudinal field simultaneously.
Have
I got that correct?
No, actually you can do a unitary rotation. You put the face, you put the gate here at the end, and you can rotate Y in a different direction. So we are simply changing the orientation of the transverse field on the XY plane. That's trivial from the physical point of view, but from the point of view of evolution, will lead us to different directions. It's also mathematically, you could think about it like changing the sign of the Hamiltonian of the interaction that we have. Apologies for this, it's how we did it in the paper. The discussion could be simpler if we simply put the original QA. but this is a technicality. So essentially what you have here is a totalized version of a problem with a transverse field that is perpendicular to the interactions that we are making. So what happens when you do that? So the initial state is just a uniform superposition. And simply accidentally, if you take a random model, the energies tend to be concentrated, and the states that are interested, they really lay out in the tails of that distribution. So if you look at the ground state, it will be here, and the highest energy state will be here. So now I'm going to apply to this state a really brief evolution with the model I showed you before. And this is what happens when I change the angle gamma, which is essentially changing the time I put this square. These are the probability distributions in energy space. I take the state and sample the probability. I pin the probabilities in the energy space. And you see that, well, the two choices of the angle lambda I put there, they can either move you to low energies or high energies. And that looks very nice because you see already that the state that was here at the tail of the distribution, which has a very interesting enhancement. So this picture, it was very nice when we saw it, but it's very much more interesting if you take this probability which was pinned and divided by the number of states. And this is what we have. So what you have is that initially you have a uniform distribution of the probabilities over all possible eigenstates of the interaction. And then you have two exponentials, one with some finite temperature and one with a negative temperature. So we're essentially preparing states that look very much like thermal states. This is what we saw, and we wanted to explore it further. So what we did then is more control experiments with broader families of problems. So we took this quantum circuit, we sampled from a variety of graphs and interactions, we sampled from a variety of problems, which includes our traditional random cubo problems, mascot problems, or random EC problems, and then we took the angles, gamma and theta that aim towards lowering the energy of the resulting state. We take the final probability distribution and we fit it to a Boltzmann distribution, assuming that it's going to be like that. So technically, we sample both random regular graphs, which have finite coordination number, is spins talking to a fixed number of spins, or completely random graphs with a fixed density, which is a number of edges divided by the number of vertices. Both are instrument parametrizations. And that not much is going to change, simply to give you two control numbers. And we took usual models, x simply are numbers in the 0, 1 places, and sigma sets are the minus 1, plus 1 usual orientations of the spin. And we take these models and we sample the elements, the q or j or field, from normal distributions with fixed standard deviation. So this gives us large families of problems, many of them fall in highly frustrated categories. With that, we do a lot of statistics, but I'm going to show you both individual instances and what happens in the whole family of problems. On the left column here, you see single instances of mascot, cubo, and random easy. And what you see essentially is like a straight line in logarithmic scale that is essentially the Boltzmann distribution tendency, and then some kind of Gaussian fluctuations you can get on top of that. If you take many problems and collapse these curves in so scaling the energies and the feeds, you see these are the feeds to Boltzmann distribution with 5 sigmas. So this is an extremely robust tendency that is the same across all models that share similar graphs and interaction strengths. So we can do these feeds, and as I told you, we have essentially one free parameter, which will be the temperature, and one noise, this delta omega, that are, we have identified as being Gaussian-type noise. I'm going to explain why we use that. And the most important thing is that the inverse temperature here, beta, that we have, is controlled by the angles that I showed you before. Essentially, the time that we work with the mixed Hamiltonian will control what is the temperature that we create in this state. Essentially, this is what happens. So the mixing angle is more or less fixed, but if you change the angle, the temperature grows linearly with the mixing angle theta. But the interesting parameter is gamma, is the strength of the interactions, how long how strong we make the cubic-cubic coupling. It gives you extremely well-collapsed fit for the linearly growing temperature beta as a function of the interaction strain. There is a limit. There is a cusp here. It's the highest inverse temperature that we can do. It's the coolest we can do the state. And that limit is shrinking with the size of the problem. What's happening there? When you reach this cusp, essentially the highest energy state has wrapped around in phase space, in phase and the angle. So that the gamma times the largest energy in your system, it became too bad. At some point, well, everything scrambles, and then you go to infinite temperature again. Yes?
So you have the fit for gamma,
show you some scalings because they come in the following plots. But before that, I'll show you this, so they look like this. We have different inverse temperatures as a function of problem size. They decay algebraically, and the fits are very good, very small errors. And of course, they depend on the problem you are looking at the density of interaction, because that gives you another energy scale. So they all, I mean, essentially, the larger your system, the hotter you are going to prepare it. Nevertheless, we see another promising feature, which is that if you look at the ground state probability, it has rover-like enhancement with respect to just uniform sampling. So this will be, this symbol that I put here is what is the enhancement in the probability of sampling the ground state with respect to the tail that we showed you before. And we see that it has a very nice exponential tendency. It's an exponential curve, but it's not an exponential enhancement. It's a Grover-like enhancement because the volume of the Hilbert space grows also exponentially. So we have to be careful with the wordings here. But we do have very good collapses for all the problems that depend essentially on the standard deviation of the coupling strengths and parameters we put in the Hamiltonians, which is sigma. On the density of the graph or the coordination number, rho z, and also, well, the betas, how much you can produce, they of course decay with problem size. So that's for granted. But on the other hand, we have to understand that it's more difficult to sample larger problems, but that difficulty also exists in the classical world. So what we have to understand is how well is the experiment performing compared to classical alternatives. And one metric that has been used in other words, like Garcia was studying what happens with variational quantum algorithms, is to look at what are the temperatures at which classical Monte Carlo can thermalize. The literature is not very conclusive on that, but there are like fixed temperatures up to constants that tell you that if you go above this temperature, Monte Carlo is going to take exponentially larger and larger times to thermalize, to give you a good sampling of the distribution. So if you look at those limits, which is a horizontal line that you may shift up and down depending on the theory paper you look at, you see that the preparations that we are doing with the simulator, they are deviating from those limits, and they provide you with an algebraic advantage over the sampling of those distributions. So essentially, this is what I was telling you before. If we have complex states that we are creating with this simulator, we have difficult probabilities of distribution to simulate classically, and we can quantify how difficult it is for the classical algorithm. Now, if you want to push this further, but this is a little bit controversial, if you look, one, compute the what would be the sample ground state probability of the classical algorithm and the probability to find the ground state with the small adiabatic passage, there is, again, some kind of algebraic improvement that increases with problem size, but this is still very much under study.
This is an empirical result?
This is a numerical result, so sampling over many problems. And we are now doing Monte Carlo simulations with parallel tempering over these families of problems to really make a little better what are the actual time to solutions for the different models. This is very nice. This looks like a nice coincidence, but we have an understanding why this happens. And what we understand now is that when you involve with this non-equilibrium Hamiltonians for a brief period of time, what you're creating is an interferometer in energy space. Think about it just for a spin. Okay? In spin, you have your problem Hamiltonian will be a sigma set component that gives you different energies to the zero and one states. Initially, you create a uniform superposition of zero and one. It's like having a beam splitter that you come one way and divide you into two paths. Each path accumulates a phase. And then what you do is that you put the compensating phase and the final mirror that joins those fields again. And you wonder what are the probabilities of being in one or the other branch of the interferometer. And if you do the analytical computation, it's very stupid. But it tells you that depending on those angles, you can either go to the highest energy states or you can go to the lowest energy states, depending on your design of the evolution and the Hamiltonian. So you can really sample both streams. What I want to argue, and this, but this is very difficult, it's in the supplementary material of the paper, is that there is a similar picture for the many body states. You can take all your spin states from the AC model and sort them from energy bottom up. Each one of them is going to give you a configuration of bits, X, and what we do with the mixing field, the transverse field, is that we connect them all together. So the ground state is connected to all of the states in energy space. This state in the middle is connected to all other states in energy space. And you can formally write down what is the wave function of the final state after the very, very great evolution. And it looks like a sum of exponentials that have the energy of the state you are looking at, Vx in this case, and the distance, the Hamming distance between that state and all other states in energy space. So this is a discrete quantity that goes from zero up to n, the number of qubits. And this is a random number that really has a distribution. It's almost continuous in the limit of a large number of spins. Now, the conceptual jump we're going to do is we are going to assume that both quantities, the increase in energy, how you move in energy space, and what is the Hamming distance, they are correlated. That's a qualitative answer, a qualitative estimate, hand-wavy approach. So we're going to do something that looks like this. We replace the sum over two variables that depends on the states by integration of a probability distribution of those quantities. And the nice thing is that we found empirically that this probability distribution for all spin models we have studied, it has a Gaussian-like nature. It looks like a block. The slope of the block has this block has a slope that is a correlation between H and E that has different amplitude and sine as you move up in the energy space. So essentially you have that this Gaussian probability is changing as you look at different states. It changes in a predictable way that can be collapsed to a very straight line for all possible models. So that means that we can empirically do this integral based on a really almost parameter-free collapse of all models, and we get essentially a Boltzmann distribution plus a random noise that is the consequence of that Gaussian block. So we have an interpretation of this model. It's interesting, so I mean, when we were discussing this with the referees, they say, okay, well, this, you have simply scrambling, you have here what you see in many physical systems, you switch in a non-equilibrium Hamiltonian, and this is Eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. This is not Eigenstate thermalization hypothesis because of two reasons. The first one is that if you take your evolution time and make it infinitely long, you go to infinite temperature. All the phases come together, really you don't get any coherent interference. You are looking at a finite window of time where this makes any sense. Another reason is that if you instead of taking a two-body interaction AC model, you take spin configurations and assign them random energies, this would work for ETH, but doesn't work for this key. So you really need a model that has some kind of ordering, some correlation between how many spin flips you have in your state and how much the energy goes up and down in the system. So it's a hidden correlation that we have witnessed for large families of models. We are now exploring what happens to more layers. We see very nice bimodal trends for working with more layers. And we are now beginning to interpret this multi-layer scenario as ways to gather insight on what happens when you design adiabatic passages assisted by these kind of algorithms, and how you can interpret this as preparing close to thermal states plus noise, plus perturbations that we want to keep under control, and a way to approach the design of quantum adiabatic passages in different ways, looking for different scopes of states and perturbations. So I push a little bit the speed of the talk to her within these 30 minutes to begin the post discussion because we are very much looking for your feedback. So our conclusion in this study in the last year and a half is that non-equilibrium dynamics with quantum simulators really they're interesting even if you have simple models like ASIC models, because they can produce states that are pure, but they, in this case, they look like Poisson distribution. So it's an interesting approach to creating new exotic states that are very difficult to sample classically. We begin to have a theoretical understanding of what happens when you do this non-equilibrium dynamics with these simulators. And we are very much looking forward to what happens when you really enhance the possibilities of longer times, different controls, and it's a way of looking at other things than just at the ground state, similar to what happens in the bi-ethernet scenario where people have been focusing on the optimal solution to an optimization problem. We can look at what states we create in the lab. So this work has been done within Abacus in collaboration with mainly Pablo, who had the first idea of looking at this from an interferometric point of view, and then we did the exploration numerically with Diego Porras, and also Fernando, who joined us recently and is studying the multi-layer scenario and so on. And just a little bit of advertising at the end, so we launched a new journal in Frontiers of Quantum Science and Technology, and we have different sections, quantum information, quantum simulation, quantum sensing, quantum engineering, and you're very much welcome to use it as a resource for the community. Thank you.
That might mean I can rush up with a microphone that people can use. So, let's get you first.
Thank you. So I was wondering, did you consider the role of disorder in these systems? Did you try to look at whether smooth results are robust against disorder in parameters?
Well, all the parameters are disordered. We take these models, they are all randomly generated. So here, simply, the interactions are normally sampled over, in this case, normal distributions, but it could be other distributions as well.
Yes, but still, say if you take a particular set of values, which I understand are chosen randomly, but then say when you do these simulations, there are additional fluctuations in your parameters. So you do need to run your problem many times, or right? So you have those additional fluctuations. I was wondering whether there is some sense in which that would change.
We did some simulations, but in the end we try not to use quantum computers for that because they are already noisy. And we saw the same distributions. We saw that the noise in the quantum computer is not so correlated as to spoil these things. And what we saw is that the scaling of the temperature changed. So we got different temperatures, but they still look like Boltzmann distribution.
Thank you.
It's a really fascinating talk. Thank you. Could you comment a little more about the higher depth results and bimodal distribution, beyond what you had on that one slide? I'm really curious about how thinking about it from a theoretical computer science point of view, that if the largest achievable beta stops decreasing with system size, or what value of P do you have to use to get that, is the most, because then that connects the PC.
These are very preliminary, so we're still doing the research and some limit problems. One added difficulty of having multi-layers that have more angles to optimize, and you have to really make sure that the paths that you are creating are really optimal. It's very easy to get trapped in local minima. That's one of the big watches of variational algorithms. We seem to be getting increasing temperatures increasing inverse temperatures for a section of the inverse space. What we don't understand yet is how many of those states participate of the good volume distribution, the coldest one, and how many belong to the nodes. That is, we don't have yet the physical intuition of what those distributions look like. And also there are some interferometric terms that we could neglect in the second layer case that are more dominant here. This oscillation is here. So it's still working for us. In the end, other people have done very deep simulations with KORFPUA. Google did a very nice paper applying this algorithm to lots of problems, but they were only looking at the ground state. And they got really nice trends for probability of finding the ground state. My understanding is we should reproduce those trends for the temperatures. What we really don't have is a picture as simple, as neat as the interferometric picture I showed you for a single step. And I don't know how to generalize it more steps. That would be pretty welcome to discuss with you.
Thank you.
I'm going to get the question here and down here.
Okay, so thank you. So you said that there is a bit controversial, the scaling advantage of QA versus Markov chain Monte Carlo. Could you elaborate a bit on that, please?
Well, the controversy is here. It's in the Monte Carlo simulations.
Okay, so you're not referring to, in the literature, but there's some
disagreement. No, it's how you compare the outcome of these experiments with the actual scaling of Monte Carlo, because there are many algorithms of Monte Carlo. The theory results we have found on when it thermalizes well doesn't tell you that you're not going to sample the ground state eventually, so the scaling of the probability of sampling the ground state is still open for understanding, and we are simply trying to work it experimentally with the best algorithms we have right now. So in the spirit of what people have been already doing with quantum annealers, try to do similar comparisons for this approach, this diabatic approach, understanding time to solutions, time to convergence of the distribution we want to sample, and so on.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm just thinking about degeneracy, and one thing that we have spent quite a bit of time looking at, not recently but years ago, is the effect of local degeneracy on kind of basins and Hamming space attracting quantum annealing.
Yeah.
So you get energy splitting due to local. You get a floppy spin, and this lowers the energy. And that can make a highly degenerate basin
yes,
very attractive to quantum annealing. Is it possible that you're seeing the same thing here?
We explored the degeneracy with these models. Formally, there is already a degeneracy in the mass-cut scenario where you have set to symmetry. And what we saw is that when you have a degeneracy or close to the degeneracy, what happens is your Hilbert space splits into powers of states that are connected by spin flips.
Mm-hmm.
We saw that then, instead of having just one Gaussian probability distribution that correlates Hamming distance to energies, you need to have more probability distributions that we have to account for in the sums. In the mass-cut scenario, it didn't seem to be very problematic. We produce exactly the same scalings. And if you look at the temperatures, if we scale properly the matrices, we don't see any difference between Kumo, which wouldn't be linear, and mass-cut. But it would be nice to understand what happens in highly frustrated scenarios, so as you say. We haven't explored that very deeply. Also, our simulations are small.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To get really interested in the degeneracies, you have to go to larger problems. We still don't know how to do that.
Done on the whole class of the models, or like
There are different instances.
Yes.
On the left, you see a single model feed.
Yes.
And then here is a collapse of all the feeds.
Okay.
Within the you have to rescale the energies and for all the problems to be properly collapsed, because we randomly sample energies, your Gaussian of energies is going to move around. But if you do it correctly, you get a very nice collapse.
Because I, for like QA, usually you have like something like concentration effects when you're looking only at the energy and not as at the distribution, like the one you're looking in this case.
Sorry, I can't hear you well.
Sorry, I'm saying that for usual kind of circuits, you have concentration effects with the system side when you look at the single, just at the average energy, for example, and not as at the distribution.
I don't know, we haven't looked at that from that point of view. It's,
okay.
It's just a four probability distribution sampled over all energy space. No, that's what we saw.
Okay, I see. What I wonder is how, let's say, how these betas change from instance to instance, right?
Well, they shouldn't change very much because the line on the left is a collapse of all the fields.
Yes, exactly. So
and the width is the standard, five standard deviations.
Yeah.
So
the concentration effect will be if you increase the size, this width becomes smaller.
But that happens already because if you increase the size, the point at which you wrap around the face also shrinks.
Yeah.
So without concentration in place, we find out that there is a limit on how much you can push these kind of applications,
mm-hmm.
because you are looking at only one layer. Mm-hmm. If you have more, you can do this evolution like a total light physics, and that we can push it forward. Yeah, this wraparound in the interferometer explains only these scales very well. And so